Hi, guys. So we're going to get... I love having this mic. Normally, I don't have this kind of mic. Thank you so much, everyone, for coming. This is... We're kicking off the Law Review's Symposium, which is going to be tomorrow, so please come, with a very special guest who is here to talk to us about his book that's coming out. So Woody Hartzog is the Starnes Professor of Law at Samford University's Cumberland School of Law. And Woody is no doubt the youngest person to ever have an endowed chair. This is our, like, love for you. But in our privacy community, say, like, no one's ever been this young and been an endowed chair. We are, and for good reason. Woody is really the foremost scholar of this country on the FTC and the FTC's role in making privacy policy. And Woody writes about so many interesting things, from robots and tort law, confidentiality and contracts, and everything. You'll see in Woody's work, at the end of the day, Woody always asks the question, well, where is design in all of these things, right? And what Woody has been working on for the last year is a brilliant book that's coming out in Harvard University Press. We're not sure in the next couple of months.
Maybe. Definitely by the fall.
Okay, good. Well, it's always good to be in the fall book list, apparently. So we get a wonderful preview of the book. And so I'm going to let Woody take it from here. But we're so grateful that you're here and sharing the book with us. And then tomorrow with really a rock star cast that I just get to basically watch. So thank you.
Thank you very much. It's really a pleasure to be here. Thanks to Danielle, thanks to Hannah, thanks to Josh, the Maryland Law Review, for putting together an excellent symposium that I think is going to be fantastic tomorrow. And so I appreciate the opportunity to come talk to you about the book. The book is done. And so my uncertainty is, yeah, yes! But it's not edited completely, so, you know, there's a lot of uncertainty left. So... the name of the book is Privacy's Blueprints, The Battle to Control the Design of New Technologies. And I want to start this talk with a few stories, actually. This is Bobby Duncan. Bobby Duncan was a student at the University of Texas, Austin, and she joined a group called the Queer Chorus, which is a choir for LGBTQ students at the University of Texas at Austin. She was very excited to do so, and the group coordinator was very excited to have her, so excited that he added her to a group list on Facebook. How many of you have used the group function on Facebook to add someone to a group? A few, so you know how this works. The problem with that was twofold. First, when she was added to the group, the Facebook group settings was not designed to match with her own privacy settings, such that her enrollment in this group was broadcast immediately to everyone in her Facebook feed. The additional problem with this is that she had not yet come out to her parents. And her father saw the post, immediately became very upset, and they have since had an estranged relationship. And it caused a lot of pain because of the design of this technology. Many of you, does anyone here remember the snappening? The snappening occurred, so first of all, how many of you use Snapchat? Show of hands. All right, so you guys know how this technology works, or most of you know how this technology works. Snapchat designed itself to be relatively ephemeral, and it warned its users, even though that the snaps, the intimate photos that were taken could be disappearing, it warned its users, by the way, don't use a third-party service, because people that use third-party services may try to save all your snaps. Right? Now, it didn't tell you this when you signed up, of course. It buried this in the terms of use that nobody reads. And it could have, if it wanted to, denied third-party services altogether by locking down its API, which is its back programming interface. But it didn't. It was an open secret that everyone knew about. And of course, people used third-party services. And of course, there were thousands, hundreds of thousands of photos that were saved and spilled online thanks to a failure of design. This is a still from a hacked baby monitor that is connected to the internet. This is one of the most disturbing things I've seen in doing research for this book, not because of what it is, but because there's an entire search engine dedicated to finding stills from hacked Wi-Fi enabled baby monitors. The reason why this was hacked was pretty easy. The default username and password were hard-coded into the firmware, and they were easy to guess by anyone that knew it. And so it was a failure of design. And then many of you are probably pretty familiar with the high profile dispute between Apple and the Federal Bureau of Investigations about the creation of a modified version of its iOS operating software in order to bypass encryption protocols and password protocols. What do all of these stories have in common? One thing. Design. The design of consumer technologies is more important than we have yet recognized. And so one of the things that I want to talk to you about is design, and I want to make three points. One, and this is what I try to make in the book, design matters for privacy. Two, privacy law should take design more seriously. And I highlight this in bold because it's the thesis of my book. Three, a design agenda should have roots in consumer protection law and surveillance law. And I say this because the current thinking about privacy by design is rooted in the fair information practice principles, which I think are important but not should not serve as the basis for design. All right. So, first, design matters for privacy. There are really three components to this. Design matters, first of all, because design is everywhere. It's so prevalent in our lives that we barely even notice it. What is this? Huh? It's a counter. That's true. On Snapchat. That's right. What does the counter do? Does anyone know? Says how long you can view a snap, right? A picture, what is a snap? A picture that you send, right? We can tell because it's got seconds, it's got the little camera. This is actually something from the promotional materials of Snapchat, but it's a picture of their user interface. If you had to guess, what do you think that Snapchat, what kind of picture do you think that Snapchat would design its services for based on this? Is it for your food, maybe? Like I'm eating a piece of pizza? That's what we designed Snapchat for? You can say it. Does nobody remember the debate around Snapchat when this thing first came out? That's right. Sexting. This is the sexting app, right? Now, what would give you that idea? It disappears, which means... Right, no regret, right? No, that's exactly right. No, seriously. This is at the heart of my book here. This is an invitation. This is an invitation to disclose sensitive information. You can tell because you're being lured into a sense of safety, right? The photo disappears after a certain second, which is different than the other kinds of media that have come out there, right? And then, of course, you see how carefully they've cropped the photo here. I saw a hand here.
It also appears to be marketed towards children.
Yeah. That's a good point. Those aren't...
Those kids don't look 18.
Probably, yeah. Definitely not senior citizens in those photos, right? All right. What's this?
Google Glass.
Google Glass. What's the privacy-relevant feature of Google Glass? Yeah, that's right. The camera, right? It was not the overlay that you could see, but it was the camera pointed outwards into the world. Design, right? This is a design feature. A lot of people think that Google Glass might have stood a chance at making it, or at least wouldn't have creeped people out quite so much if the camera hadn't been there. Now, I'll also point out that privacy-relevant design is also built into Google Glass because they had a little light that was supposed to turn on every time it was in use. right? So a sort of a notice function. They also had a really interesting sort of design-related prohibition in their terms of use. Google Glass prohibited the use of facial recognition technologies in their terms of use, which is really interesting, and I thought maybe a underreported element of Google Glass when everyone said it's going to be the end of privacy. What is this? You guys know what this is. Huh? Incognito mode in Chrome. That's exactly right. Why would this represent incognito mode?
Because he's like a super creepy spy dude.
That's right. Right? He's got the collar turned up, right? It's like in the old-fashioned movies where like nobody can see the guy. Again, this is an implicit invitation to disclose something more safely, right? Because you're hidden. You're in incognito mode. Except, of course, that's not how it works, right? Now, to Google's credit, they say, by the way, this is incognito mode, but not really, right? Whenever you open it up, these following people can still see you. But if it were presented without that and you just saw this, you might think to yourself, well, I'm pretty safe disclosing here. This is, you know, they can't see this guy, they can't see me. So design is everywhere, right? We don't even notice it because it's so prevalent. It affects the images, our risk calculations, inherent risk calculations, design, meaning, and when I say design, I mean the actual architecture of technology, the way that something is built, the signals that it gives off, and the way it makes things easier or harder, right? Design accomplishes tasks. It increases transaction costs or reduces transaction costs for certain kinds of activities, and it's everywhere. Everything is design, right? So design is everywhere. Design is also power. It affects our expectations. It makes things more likely or less likely. And I want to give an example here, and I have to read. So Alessandro Acquisti and a group of other researchers engaged in a fascinating little experiment, one of my favorites in all of psychology research. They had people sit down and they were filling out a questionnaire, and you can see that it's sort of cute, right? It's got the little devil. It's like, how bad are you? You can tell me, right? And it asked some relatively serious questions here. Have you ever smoked marijuana? Have you ever cheated while in a relationship? Have you ever driven when you were pretty sure you were over the legal blood alcohol level? It's asking you to admit to committing a crime. And so it collected the results. And then in its control group, it had them answer a different sort of user interface. Have you ever smoked pot or weed? Have you ever cheated while in a relationship? Have you ever driven while you were pretty sure you were over the legal blood alcohol level? The only difference, of course, the exact same questions. The only difference, of course, is the imprimatur, right? The design. This design is frivolous. It's written in, I think that's Comic Sans. It's got the little playful devil. The other one is Carnegie Mellon, right? And this was Carnegie. It was done as Carnegie Mellon. And so now I have to get to this point where I read because I want to make sure to represent the actual statistics right. So these were basically designed to be frivolous and non-frivolous types. And the researchers wanted to say, well, what was the interface, the design interface that was to make you more likely to disclose? All right. Relative to the non-frivolous interface, participants in the frivolous-looking survey that asked identical questions were, on average, 1.7 times more likely to admit to having engaged in risky behaviors. For example, a participant in the frivolous-looking survey was, on average, 2.03 times more likely to admit having ever taken nude pictures of himself or a partner. And the researchers concluded, people, it seems, feel more comfortable providing personal information on unprofessional sites that are arguably particularly likely, unlikely to misuse it, or arguably particularly likely to misuse it. And so people, basically, the more informal it was, the more likely they were to disclose really sensitive information based only on design alone. And we see this replicated time and time again with user interface studies. And that brings me to an issue. So design is everywhere. Design is power. And a third point that I want to make is that design is political. I've given this talk a few times, and I've given the thesis for this talk a number of times. And sometimes afterwards, people will come after and they'll say, well, I don't really agree because you're really attacking technology. And it's not the technologies that are bad. It's the users that are bad. right? And I hear this argument a fair bit. There are no bad technologies, only bad technology, only bad technology users. This sounds a little bit similar to what? Guns don't kill people, kill people. I think that's patently false, right? I think that every single design decision, because it makes a certain reality more or less likely, is inherently political, right? It is value-laden. Even if you choose to ignore something, you're basically acquiescing to a certain reality, right? Because the point of design, in the way that I'm articulating it, is to make something more or less likely or to communicate some sort of signal. I think that's one of the reasons why privacy law has gotten off on a bad foot, is that it seems to be following this mantra. Now, there are other reasons why lawmakers have ignored the design of technologies. There's fear of overreaching. There's fear of ham-fisted technological control that's going to engage in really bad design. But I think this is one of the things that's a really powerful argument that I want to push back against. All right, so now let me get to the second point that I'd like to talk about, which is that privacy law should take design more seriously. In short, privacy law has a design gap. Privacy law, which is, of course, in the United States, a sort of patchwork, right? It's a little bit of tort law. It's a little bit of what we call data protection law, which is the Federal Trade Commission enforcing against unfair and deceptive trade practices. Around the world, in Europe, there's what we call the General Data Protection Regulation, which is data processing. And we care a lot about what people do with data. We care a lot about people collecting information. We care a lot about people using information. We care a lot about people disclosing that information, right? It's a real heavy focus on data processors. But privacy law, by and large, has largely ignored design. And I think that that's a massive mistake. The reason why, if you look at the three rules of privacy, and in my book, I admit that I'm being incredibly overly reductive by saying that there are basically only three rules of privacy, but there are really only three rules of privacy, and all three of them have a massive design gap. Let me explain what I mean. One of the first and most important rules of privacy, if you really were to ask someone what is privacy, they would say, well, follow the FIPS. Follow the Fair Information Practice Principles. What are the FIPS? The FIPS are a set of guidelines that form the foundation for all of modern privacy law. They were originated in an advisory committee report for the U.S. Health and Education and Welfare. That's right, Department of Health and Education and Welfare, which were then eventually instantiated in the OECD guidelines, which then serve the basis for every privacy law in the world. And the rules you probably are relatively familiar with, right? You should give people accountability, right? You should give them transparency. You should give data accuracy. You have data minimization. Only collect what you need. But what it all really comes down to, if you see it instantiated in the law, is one simple rule, which is give people control. That sounds good. I like control. If you ask people at Facebook what they want to do for their users, they will say, we want to give users control. If you ask Microsoft, what's your goal? They say, we want to give users more control. If you ask people what their definition of privacy is, most of them will tell you, not everyone, but a lot of them, and I asked this for the very first day of privacy law, what is everyone's definition of privacy? The most common definition I get is control over personal information. I want it. It's good, right? Control furthers autonomy, which is great. There's a problem with the control mentality. It's almost turned into a fetish. What is this? I know you guys know it, but I like to have a little give and take in my lectures. Huh?
Toggle.
It's a toggle. It's an on-off toggle, right? This is a way of effectuating control in design. This is exactly what Facebook is bending over to give its users, right? Apple says you have to give users control. The Federal Trade Commission says you need to give users control, right? I just heard one of the commissioners speak recently, and she said, we're focusing on giving good consumer choice and control, and this is one way to do it. It sounds great. I like the toggle button. I'm on board. So I download my app. I say I want control over how my personal information is used. I press my toggle button. And I say, don't you collect my geographic location, right? Okay, that's good. So then I look back, I say, okay, well, I've got a few choices here. All right, so find my iPad. Well, I guess that's a good one. Location-based ads, I guess I'll turn that one off. Share my location. Well, with who? That's not really clear, but I guess I'll turn it on. And you sort of fiddle with this for a little while, and you get it to how you like it, right? Because I want to be able to control my information, and this is good. And I get it set, right? Okay, finally, now I'm set. I sit back, I take a deep breath, and I go, oh, dear. I've got a lot of work to do. The problem with control and regimes that prioritize control is they do not account for the fact that control is a finite resource. There's only so much of it that we can expend before we fully just give up, right? And so a lot of people, I get some criticism, they say, well, you hate control, control is good. I actually love control. I think control is the greatest, but I recognize that it's valuable, right? It's far too valuable to waste to say that everything should be a matter of control. And that's the problem with FIPS-based regimes, which you're going to hear me rant about this tomorrow as well, by the way, is that they basically devolve into control regimes, and the control, the way in which these regimes are created is they don't recognize the fact that we can only exercise so much control before it becomes meaningless. All right. Rule 1 of privacy law, design is used to circumvent control. Right? It's like a DDoS attack on our brains. 2, do not lie. The primary bread and butter of the Federal Trade Commission, and the way that they've been enforcing privacy for the past number of years, is they say, do not lie. Right? If you're going to just tell people what you're going to do with their personal information and don't be coy about it, right? Just don't be deceitful about it. Just say, do not lie. The problem with do not lie is that it easily falls into a formalism, right? A sort of rote formalism where we can sort of be technically accurate and then use design to sort of circumvent things, right? And so we can change impressions. You remember the user interfaces? We can change user interfaces to make you feel one way, even though we're technically, with words, being very explicit about what it is we're doing. And so do not lie then falls into the trap where it's subject to capture through design. The same goes with do not harm, right? Those are the 3 rules for privacy. Follow the FIPS, do not lie, do not harm. Do not harm leads us to sort of chase these harms that are really visceral, right? So Danielle has actually written a fantastic paper on privacy harms, which I recommend to everyone, that rightly criticizes regimes that say, well, you know, you got to have some real demonstrable harm, right? Risk of harm alone isn't going to cut it. And that's what we see. So how many of you in your life have described privacy practice as creepy, right? You don't like it because it's creepy. No one has used that? Okay, there we go. So we get a few, right? The do not harm mentality forces us into trying to articulate these things, right? Well, I don't like it because it's creepy. What it is it's just really dispersed, right, or finite. Privacy harms in the modern age, which I would include sort of the wheedling out of a disclosures a little bit at a time, slow little accretions, are really hard to measure when you have a law, particularly with cases like Spokio, that are demanding this sort of really concrete, particularized sort of harm. And design is used to sort of inflict lots of little mini harms, right? Whereas instead of one big one. And so we've got this design gap. And so the book is about trying to make a turn to design. So they say, okay, if design has a gap, what are you going to do about it? This is what I propose we do about it. There are 3 parts to the blueprint. I say privacy laws should take design more seriously, and it should start at 3 different layers. The first layer is the value layer, right? So we have to articulate, well, what do we want design to actually do for us, and what do we want to keep design from threatening? The second is boundaries. What are some ways to articulate when design has gone too far? And then the third is tools. What can lawmakers do to help create good design, encourage good design, and discourage bad design? All right. So first, the values. Now, this is a really interesting part because I recognize that there are lots of values inherent in privacy. So I'm not one of these people that thinks that there's one definition of privacy. I think that privacy is an umbrella concept that applies to a lot of different things. And so you could pick a lot of different values, things like dignity, things like intimacy. But in my book, I pick 3. And I pick these 3 for specific reasons because in my book, I say the design is primarily about 2 things, sending signals, right, communicating information about the terms of some sort of relationship or the way in which a technology works. to a user of a technology and facilitating transaction costs, making things easier to do or making things harder to do. And if you look at what signals and transaction costs do, they largely proceed along three lines. One, they cause us to trust people more or trust people less, maybe more than we should or not enough. They can affect how obscure we are, right? In other words, and I'll get to what obscurity is, but basically how difficult it is to find and understand information. And then finally, the third value I choose is autonomy, which is we need the autonomy to be able to engage in relationships of trust and maintain and create zones of obscurity. So I sort of cabin autonomy because I tether it to notions of trust and obscurity. All right, so what do I mean by trust? I think that the FIPS fall into a problem where it's seeking control because it refuses to accept what I call a trust model, right? Which is that inherently we need to be able to trust everyone in order to survive in the modern world. In the digital economy, we trust everybody, right? Implicitly. You go out to dinner, you pay for someone something with your credit card. You trust your waiter with your credit card number. You don't think about it, but you do. And there's a theory of trust and privacy that I've been developing with Neil Richards at Washington University that says that trust is really about four different things. It's about discretion, it's about honesty, it's about protection, which is sort of related to the FIPS, but we would sort of juice those up a little with affirmative duties. And most importantly, it's about loyalty, which is not using people's information against them in adversarial ways. And I explain a little bit about what that means. I need a clock here. I want to make sure I'm doing okay on time. Am I okay? Okay. Is it five? Okay. What is obscurity? One of the most common examples, so I speak about privacy a fair bit. I was speaking to a group of retirees about a week ago, and I said what I was talking about, and a hand goes up, and I said I was talking about privacy, and the hand goes up, and he said, there is no privacy anymore. And I get that a lot, right? There's a fair amount of privacy fatalism going around. But I argue that a lot of that privacy fatalism is based on a conceptualization of privacy as secrecy. Right, that I have information that's secrets, right? That if other people know it, then it must be not private. Of course, trust counteracts that a little bit, right? We disclose people information we trust. We disclose information to people we trust all of the time. But another aspect of privacy that I think is underlooked is that we're private all the time. If private is the likelihood of information being found or understood. How many of you have gone out to eat in a restaurant in the past week? Few? Do any of you remember who was sitting to the left or to the right of you? What they looked like? What they were talking about? You do? That's pretty impressive. I don't remember. I was sitting on a plane 6 hours ago, and I have no clue what anyone else on the plane really looked like, right? I wasn't paying attention to them. I don't know what they were talking about. They were talking about something, but I wasn't listening. These are the zones of obscurity that we live our lives in, right? I walked outside. I walked from my hotel right here. I was in public, right? I was in full view of anyone else, but I didn't think anyone was actually watching me. These are the assumptions that we base all of our risk calculations truly upon, right? When we share information with someone, we don't knowingly expose ourselves to all the world. We make limited disclosures, disclosures within zones of obscurity that have an implicit risk calculation that says, I bet most people aren't going to see me, right? Has anyone here ever walked by the room in your hotel, the window in your hotel room, and you weren't fully clothed, right? I mean, I'll go ahead and tell you I have. Right? What are the odds that someone was going to be standing there taking a photo of me? Not good, right? Most people aren't sitting there staring at hotel windows all day ready to take the snapshot of someone walking by in their underwear. But there was an unfortunate woman who walked out in her underwear to pick up the newspaper, and the Google streetcar had driven right by and took a photo of her. And it started a really interesting debate on the internet. They said, well, she's in public. That's not private. But is that really the way in which we live our information? Have you ever gossiped with someone over lunch? You probably thought that was relatively private information, right? Or in the hallway. You were doing it in public. Obscurity is the way in which we live our lives, and technology can facilitate that obscurity, right? Privacy settings are a really good example on Facebook. I call them obscurity settings, right? Because they make it less likely that someone is going to find your information, right? If you lock down all of your information on social media with privacy settings, chances are the HR representative who's going to be doing a Google search on you isn't going to see your Facebook posts. And that's good enough for most of the time. This is what I think should be valued in technology design, and I think that lurches of obscurity, those technologies that dramatically eviscerate obscurity, should be mitigated against. And I talk about online, obscurity is actually a function of at least four different things. Search visibility, how searchable is something, unprotected access, what's the degree of access, did you protect something with a password or privacy settings, identification, sometimes your full name is listed, sometimes just your first name, sometimes just initials, right? The likelihood of anyone linking you back to something is really implicit on how identified you are, and clarity. Right? If I were to post on my Facebook account right now, it's positive. And let's say it was open and you did a quick Facebook search, you found me and you saw that, you would have no idea what that meant. Now, if you knew that my wife and I were trying to conceive a child and I'm announcing it to the world, then that would be good news to you because you have the information necessary to make sense of that disclosure, right? That's a zone of obscurity. We're protected all the time by lack of clarity. It's called steganography, or hiding in plain sight. And then finally, autonomy. We need the ability to engage in relationships of trust, right? I like autonomy. My friend Margo is here, and we've talked a lot about what autonomy is. And I get accused sometimes of a sort of paternalism here where they say, well, you're trying to tell companies how to build their technologies and tell people how to live their lives. And I say, well, no, I value autonomy. But the problem with autonomy, generally speaking, is that if you don't cabin it off appropriately, then it is everything, right? Like autonomy is freedom from all interference from everyone forever. And so what I do in my book is I try to cabin it off to the ability to create relationships of trust by using technologies or the ability to maintain reliable zones of obscurity with technologies. And I label that as a value. All right. So the design agenda should have roots in consumer protection and surveillance law as opposed to the fair information practices. What do I mean by that? I mean that if we're creating boundaries, right, for what is and is not permissible in design, let's do so around deceptive design, design that lies to us. Let's do that around abusive design, design that exploits our own vulnerabilities, particularly our mental limitations against us. And dangerous design, design that jeopardizes our risk calculations or otherwise puts us in danger. What do I mean by that? Deceptive design is relatively easy, but we see it all the time, and it's not really actionable. So if you were to press this button, add friends, you would think that you would be able to manually add friends. But the FTC actually filed a complaint that said this was deceptive design because what it really did is it automatically went through your entire contact book and sent out invitations to everyone and gave us access to your contact book. And chances are that's not what you thought that button did, which is a piece of deception, right? They say that this design lied to you. One of my favorite FTC complaints is actually the complaint against Snapchat, where they say, you made it seem as though these images disappeared, right, went away. But they didn't really. They were stored on your hard drive. They were easily accessible by the person who received them. They were saved. And so you did a lot through design, not just through words, but through design to entice this, and you basically lied to people. Abusive design. There's a lot of literature out there that talks about the limits of cognition and heuristic biases that we sort of fall back on to make decisions because to avoid cognitive overburdening. In other words, our brain can only handle so much, and so we come up with little tricks and shortcuts to process that. That could be used against us relatively easily. There are also some sorts of design that can leverage our own personal information against us in discriminatory ways, right? So I always try to find the pressure points with my privacy class. Sometimes it's Facebook, sometimes it's harassment, sometimes it's government surveillance. But I was having one privacy class, I was trying to find everyone's pressure point, what they really got upset about. And I couldn't find anything. I was like, what about government surveillance? And I would sort of try to egg them on. They're like, oh, no, that's cool. And I'd say, well, what about Facebook? And they'd say, oh, yeah, we like give Facebook everything. And I couldn't get them angry about anything. And then I brought up the example about, do you remember a few years ago when it was revealed that Orbitz, the traveling website, was showing different hotel rooms based upon whether you were using a PC or a Mac? And if you were using a Macintosh, then you got the expensive hotel rooms first. And if you were using a Windows, you got the cheaper ones. The idea being that if you used a Macintosh, you probably had more money. My students were outraged. They could not believe how, the gall of Orbitz to use my personal information against me. They didn't even realize that they were sort of broadcasting that out into the world. And so this is possibly an example of abusive design. That's a relatively innocuous one. But in the book, I talk about a few more that could be really pernicious about designing systems to leverage our personal information against us in adversarial ways. And then finally, dangerous design. What is dangerous design? Dangerous design is design that intentionally thwarts our risk calculations or prevents our ability to protect ourselves. This is a really good example of it. This is a camera. It's a spy cam, to be precise, and it's explicitly designed for covert surveillance, right? And it's because it's on a sort of coat rack, then it's specifically designed to catch people in places where they're probably going to be taking clothes off, right? I think this is a particularly nasty piece of technology and one in which I think privacy laws should take more seriously because it cannot be argued that this is some value-neutral sort of technology, right? This was explicitly designed to catch people in a certain sense. Now, we can have a debate as to whether the value of such technologies outweighs the drawbacks of it, which is one that I'm happy to have. But right now, we're not even having that debate. Now, there are some exceptions, right? So spyware is actually technically illegal. Trafficking in spyware, Danielle has written a very good piece called Spying Inc. about this. But I basically say, let's take the logic of the spyware prohibition and push that even further. Now, a lot of pushback that I get when I give this talk is that you are advocating a top-down control over technologies, right? You're squelching innovation. You're telling people how to build their technologies. And this is particularly anathema. And I'm sensitive to this critique. There's a whole part in the book where I say a lot of what lawmakers should do is just keep their hands off technology, particularly when it comes to encryption. I don't mean to say that I'm advocating some bureaucrat, slamming her fist down on the desk yelling, shut it down, shut it all down now, right? I think that there should be a robust but widely varied response, soft responses. Sometimes what design needs, good privacy design needs, is some cold, hard cash, right? Sometimes we could just work to create better standards. The Internet of Things is we use the term Wild West a lot, and that metaphor gets sort of played out. But right now, the Internet of Things is a bit of a Wild West in that there are no real set standards for what it is. We could use improvement on that, right? And so that's a soft response. That's a way in which privacy law could take design more seriously, is to take the creation of international standards more seriously. Moderate responses. We could improve contract law. We could improve tort law. We could look at this and say, what's really being promised to users is not what's in the terms of use. What's really being promised to users is not in the privacy policy, but it's this stuff, right? It's padlock icons. It's attempts to lure you into feelings of safety, right? And some of these may be innocuous, but some of them might not be. And the FTC has done a relatively good job of trying to recognize when design is deceptive. But I think that contract law could also have something to say about it, or tort law with inducement to breach confidentiality. And then finally, the robust responses would be a little bit more of the heavy-handed, outright regulatory prohibitions. I think it's right that we criminalize spyware, and there's some other ones where I think we could use perhaps a licensing regime. There's some people that have floated that out for the Internet of Things. I'm not a fan of that generally, but there might be some areas in which we might want to have a licensing regime or at least some sort of credentialing regime for the IoT to make it a little safer because we're seeing some real harm emerge from the Internet of Things now. And I'll stop because I want to leave room for Q&A. In the book, the final three chapters are implementing the blueprint. And I talk about how does the blueprint work in social media, how does it work for hide-and-seek technologies, and how does it work for the Internet of Things. And so that's it. And now I'll open it up for questions. Thank you all very much.
a microphone that we can pass. Oop, there goes my phone. But I think I'm going to ask a question, if that's okay.
Sure.
Does, because these technologies move so quickly, you know, that, you know, 1 minute we have a phone, we get a new phone, right? We design moves at the speed of light, right? Sort of Moore's Law idea, that law moves really slowly. So in that moderate model and then the more robust model of law, because it moves so slowly, that if we were to have a consumer protection model that either requires on a, you know, look, relies on a law enforcer or lawsuits that move really slowly, will we be four generations down the road by the time we litigate? And is that something that you worry about?
Yes, very much. And in the book, I talk a lot about have you gone over the difference between rules and standards in any of your classes now? So rules are highly specific and highly deterministic, where standards are very indeterminate. There's a lot of room. I argue for standards, a standards approach to the blueprint, which I think would really facilitate a lot of change better. So I also tend to favor bottom-up. I like the FTC's complaint-by-complaint approach because it's pretty nimble, which is one of the reasons I'm actually a little bearish on robust responses to design, is I would prefer soft and moderate responses because I'd much rather have ground-up, slow incremental change rather than someone come out and say, this particular user interface is the best for social media, when, you know, 10 years from now, who knows whether we'll even be using that word anymore. So I would caution against that, which is why I like the light stuff first.
I just, pardon me, I had a question about how we get people to care about intrusions on privacy, particularly over the internet. I know we've got a lot of lawmakers, for example, who are of an age where they didn't necessarily grow up with or even encounter these technologies until later in life. And I'm thinking specifically about there are some considerations about thinking about the possibility of Russian interference with U.S. government officials' emails and phishing scams. There's a sense that it was just on the internet, so it's intangible. There's that kind of a kind of cognitive dissonance there, and I just wanted to know your thoughts on how we get people to make that connection.
Sure, absolutely. So this is something I'm very passionate about because I'm, you know, screaming privacy from the top of my lungs. I do think that a lot of people care about privacy, just not using the language that we normally use, right? So we care about whether the people we trust with our information are going to betray us, right? Instinctually. As a matter of fact, there was a recent study that came out that showed that in the absence of any meaningful indications of privacy, what people rely upon is basically a brand name. The established brand name. So we trust Amazon because they've been around for a while. They probably are doing a pretty good job, right? I mean, that's really the sort of heuristic that we use. And so when we think about privacy in terms of trust, I think it becomes a little easier to talk about. And so even though I just said I scream privacy, I actually don't like that word very much. And I would rather talk in terms of trust, right? Violated trust. Or I use the word obscurity because then it gives us a little bit of sense of more of our everything that we do, whereas most people think about, well, I don't have a secret, right? This is where the nothing to hide argument comes from. And then finally, maybe this is a little controversial, but I don't think our privacy law should be based upon people caring about privacy. I think that's where the FIPS went wrong, right? That we're seeking control based on this assumption that we all care so much about every single decision that's being made with respect to our personal information. What I would really like to see is an approach where we tried to find some ground rules that more or less everybody agreed upon, and we started prioritizing the decisions that we wanted to make, right? So there may be true diverse privacy preferences. A lot of the argument I get is, well, people have different privacy preferences, so we shouldn't legislate, otherwise you're being paternalistic. That's probably true to an extent. But I think that a lot of what is being chalked up as diverse privacy preferences, if you really got down to it, is basically really bad risk assessment. right? So we're saying, oh yeah, I trust this person with that, right? When really what it is you just suck at analyzing risk, which is true actually of humans generally, right? We're actually just really quite bad at that. And so I'd rather see a regime that wasn't so dependent upon people caring about their privacy. That's not to say that we should be absolved. I think that there are tools that everyone should use if they're given the tools. Two-factor authentication is probably the best argument for this, right? Everyone, all of you, if you can turn on two-factor authentication for any of your services, I implore you to do so because it's a very simple way to protect yourself. But you know, lawmakers have to meet us halfway or more.
Well, one of the things we classically teach are races to the bottom. So when Delaware lowers the minimum wage, there's great pressure on Maryland to lower the minimum wage. Have you observed, is it a problem in technology, what we might call a race to the top? Namely, that technologies are driven by the most sophisticated users. To give a very simple example, when the highly specialized data crunchers need new computers with more sophisticated software, all the faculty, including the legal historians, get the new computers with the sophisticated software, and it takes us 6 months to learn how to word process again. But is this a problem that, given the primary demand are the most sophisticated users, inevitably the precautions will be ones they handle well, but will leave the less sophisticated users vulnerable? In this sort of the race to the top mentality.
Right. I think if I understand your question correctly, I agree with you, which would be why I don't like building policy around the notion of control, which actually might end up favoring those who are technologically sophisticated to effectuate control, because that's not everybody, right? So I'm not a first adopter of a lot of technologies, and I'm slow to getting to certain things. And if privacy is meant to be for everyone, which I would argue that it is, then we need to have a policy that doesn't reward first adopters. And also built into this is when we have control and, you know, sort of self-help, privacy self-help, it's just this implicit expectation that those with all the resources are the ones that are able to help themselves, right? And one of the things that I really worry about is we get into a lot of, and there's more than one, I get that there's more than one side of the issue about paying for privacy, but AT&T was offering, I think it was AT&T Verizon, do you remember the super cookie discussion? They were saying that basically they were going to put a super cookie on everyone's computers, and that for $15 you didn't have to have the super cookie, right? And that they would take the super, it was tracking off. And so basically what this turned down to is if you had money, you could get privacy, right? And I actually worry a lot about this, the regressive effects of that. And related to that, tomorrow you'll hear me give a spiel for competition law being a bigger, anti-competition law being a bigger part of privacy law because of data monopolies and the way in which companies are using data, they get entrenched and it's difficult to unseat them.
Have you thought about, do you have thoughts about including these issues in product liability law?
I'm so glad you asked that. Yes, I do, and there's actually an explicit part in the book where I advocate modeling a lot of the boundaries that we use. Oh, I think I accidentally. A lot of the boundaries that we use based on products liability law, which has a lot to teach us. So I'm a torts professor. And I love Carol Towing. I love the learned hand balancing formula. I love reasonable alternative design as a means for determining, whether someone's gone out of bounds. The key, and this is the hard part, is that we're going to need to have a serious conversation about imposing liability for software, which judges have been really reluctant to do. And I think for a lot of good reasons. But as the IoT starts merging with traditional products, I think it's time we revisited that, at least in a limited kind of way. And if there's a way to sort of recognize liability for software without opening the floodgates, then I'd be in favor of that. But in the very least, maybe we could borrow from some of the tests that we use in crafting regulatory rules.
Well, my I'm a trial judge, and my perspective is that it is not practical or, in my view, a good idea to try to legislate everything. But apprehension of liability is a self-regulation mechanism, which can be very important, very, very effective.
I completely agree. Thank you very much.
In 2017, do you think companies are incentivized to have the strongest possible security laws for their data, for privacy settings that they possibly can? As in, do you think companies should, I guess, try to be have the highest security regulations possible to incentivize customers to trust them and, I guess, like spend their money with them if it's a paid service?
Oh, so are you saying, is there a market for privacy, right? Or so are we seeing a sort of, I mean, that's been the dream for a long time, is that customers, that businesses would see that providing privacy is mutually beneficial, is good for business because it creates long-term sustainable relationships where people are going to be willing to disclose even more. I think that there are some companies that are taking that pretty seriously in the sense that the reputational fallout from a breach is really bad. And companies are trying pretty hard. I don't think that major companies, even those that have been hacked, a lot of them have put a lot of resources into it. The problem is twofold. One, you can throw all the technology you can after a hack, but if someone wants to hack you, you still get hacked. And so there's no such thing as perfect safety. But two, one of the things I worry about is the opaque nature of data collection and a lot of data use, and the way in which promises from privacy can be made to sort of gain benefits, and then design can be used to thwart a lot of that, or a lot of the harm that we're seeing now is things like that's affecting anti-discrimination law, right? And so privacy law is more than just data collection and you know, sort of transparency, and I think it's moving beyond ways in which information is used by those in power to gain even more power. I don't think there's a lot of incentive for that part. I think there's a lot of incentive for companies to follow the FIPS, right? At least formalistically. But I'm not convinced that the market is working beyond that.
You mentioned about explicit design, and I was curious about how that plays into, you know, explicit design and malicious use of it. About the use of drones today, we see the development of drones becoming smaller. They're using more to maliciously violate people's privacy. I'm curious what your take on that is, particularly for the government's use of drones. What's their limitation on it?
Yeah. So we've got someone in the audience here who knows significantly more about drone policy than I do. But to the extent that drones are being used to violate people's privacy, the question I get a lot is actually, can I shoot a drone out of the sky? There's several actually good articles on that online out there. My argument would be obscurity related with drones, and this is where I feel the most passionately. So I think that the FAA should focus on building design into drones, but what that means is not yet clear. Does it mean you have to erase data after a certain while? Does it mean that there are sort of no-fly zones that you should implement in the firmware of the drones, which might be a good idea? I mean, it's already sort of a mess trying to figure out where a drone would fly. The only point that I feel really strongly about, that I'll scream from the top of the mountain, is that simply being in public does not give anyone operating a drone a license for continuous surveillance, which is often the opposite conclusion that we get. And the example that I use in class is, if I'm standing outside of University of Maryland Law School and someone pulls out their iPhone and takes a picture of me, is that a privacy violation? Probably not, right? I mean, I was standing in public and I realized that there's some limits, right? To what you can ask of people. What about if they take that iPhone camera and put it on a drone and then take a photo of me, probably not a privacy violation, right? What about if they take that drone that now has the iPhone camera and follow me back to my hotel, but don't go inside the hotel, just park outside the hotel? Is that a privacy violation? Probably not, but I'm getting a little more uncomfortable now. What about if that drone locks on to my GPS coordinates and follows me around only in public for 3 months, right? It stops right outside of the building. You know, we can recharge drones with, like, lasers now. I don't think that's actually true, but there is the technology. But there's I've read that the technology exists. And so this is like a Woody drone, right? And the Woody drone is just only following me in public. I think that's a clear privacy violation. And so, and the reason why is because it violated our obscurity, right? It really affected our risk calculus. The normal time that we're outside, we're not expecting someone to be following us literally at all times. So that's the argument that I would push back from the drones. And then I'll leave those who know a lot more about drone law than myself to answer the more sophisticated questions.
You mentioned the FTC already does use design in calculating kind of what is misleading or deceptive. What, in your theory, would you add to how they already consider design, or what changes do you think should be made?
Sure. What I'd like to see is a little bit more of a cohesive approach about what deceptive design is. So a little bit more examples about this explicit signals from design that did, in fact, deceive someone. The FTC does a good job of this, but what we really need is just a lot more complaints that may be requesting something that's not going to happen because the FTC has relatively limited resources. And then the other one, which is also, I think, at least recently, unlikely to happen in the relative future, is a little bit of an expansion on what is considered an unfair, a piece of unfair design. One of the things I think that if you were to really see them push on the avant-garde is what I call obscurity lurches, which is a rapid making available of certain kinds of information, almost akin to a data breach, right? So if data, for example, if Facebook were to all of a sudden switch your privacy settings all to public rapidly overnight, what would happen is that would trigger a sort of cascading series of things, one of which, if it's indexed by Google, then it would start showing up on Google. People would be able to find it. I would call that an obscurity lurch, and the reason why is because it would dramatically affect our ability to respond to protect ourselves, to create zones of obscurity. And so I think that would border on an unfair trade practice, but I'm not sure that the FTC is willing to go there or not. Because for lots of reasons, the FTC is reluctant to sort of step too far beyond its sort of narrowly defined area of unfairness. And because the harm is not entirely clear. That's another reason. We like to see a little more tangible harm.
So you've been talking about the FTC and privacy, but what are your thoughts about the FCC's role? Because, I mean, as you talk about net neutrality, anti-discrimination, transparency, data breaches, things like that, which have been within the FCC's role. So how do those overlap?
Well, so that's I've got some complex feelings on the FCC right now. I think that the FCC's privacy rules were relatively well thought out, and that they've got some important protections. One of the things that was the negative drawback of the FCC reclassifying broadband as a common carrier for net neutrality purposes is that it created a dispute between the Federal Trade Commission and the Federal Communications Commission, which the FTC by statute does not have jurisdiction over common carriers. Now, what a common carrier actually is, I think, is open to debate, and we're actually seeing that play out in the courts. To the extent that the FCC starts stripping power away from the FTC, I actually would not wish for that result, because I think that the Federal Trade Commission plays a critically important role as the basically data protection authority on the beat for the United States. Every other country in the world that follows an EU-style regime, which is a lot of them because they all want to collect sorry, maybe cynically, data on European citizens, is has a data protection authority, right? Some sort of centralized organization that enforces the data protection rules. And if the FTC starts getting carved up too much, then it's going to lose that. And there's going to be a sort of cascading series of bad consequences from that. So, but I do think the FTC plays a role, although I think that we're about to see, if I had to guess, the entire scope of the FTC's jurisdiction change, possibly dramatically, and soon.
Just tacking off of what you just said about the EU and their kind of approach to data privacy, how do you think that we, as America, are there international examples of what is going right in privacy law? Do you think that we can learn from our international, I guess, friends, or are we, as you know, the American government, are we kind of leading the way in privacy?
I think there are areas. A lot of the action right now is happening with the General Data Protection Regulation, which is the new law in the European Union that's coming into effect for data protection throughout. I think there are aspects of that piece of legislation that are really interesting, particularly for design. And I talk about this in the book a little. They, within the new GDPR, they're establishing what they call privacy by default, which is if you have a privacy option, then by default it should be the privacy protective option, because we know the defaults are sticky, right? I mean, how many of you actually go in there and do the toggle button? Not many of us. Maybe the privacy conscious, but not a ton unless you're sort of prompted to do so. And so that's a really interesting design protection, and I'm excited to see how that takes on, because I do think that that could buttress the FIPS-based regime that we've largely seen and shore up a lot of its shortcomings. But that being said, the GDPR also still banks a lot on notions of consent, which is really a control regime. And consent can sort of heal all. It doesn't recognize consent as a limited resource. It sort of asks it of you over and over and over. Now, it does go a little further and say that you need meaningful consent, so it can't be just totally buried in the boilerplate. But that's even a greater demand of resources, right, that we need to spend scrolling through Facebook or reading email or doing 1,000 other things, right? And so a lot of people say, oh, well, the true consent or meaningful consent is an improvement. But at the end of the day, it's just asking more from us that I don't think that we as users really have that much to give. So yes and no, actually. I do the classic law professor thing where I say, well, we're good in some ways, but not in others, and they're good in some ways, but not in others.
Are there things that you do to maintain, to protect your privacy that the average person is not doing? And is there a way to kind of educate the average user on how to better protect themselves, maybe before privacy law catches up?
Yes, and yes. So I'll give another shout out for two-factor authentication. One thing that people may not know is that they're really great. Google's got a great two-factor authentication app that works really well. It's actually better than text messages. So just turn that on. It's very simple. It's very easy. One thing that I do that a lot of people that don't, if you go to my Twitter account here, you'll notice that I'm account protected. That's not to hide from you. That's to hide from Google, basically, and bots. Because one of the things that I try to get people in the habit of is realizing that things that the difference between posting something that can be indexed by Google and posting something that can't be indexed by Google. And open tweets are, right? And as a matter of fact, Twitter turns them over to the Library of Congress, whereas protected tweets aren't. And so that's a simple thing. I mean, of course, that does cut into the utility of Twitter. I fully understand. But that's something that I do that maybe a lot of other people don't do. But otherwise, I don't think that I'm overly more paranoid than most people with respect to you know, guiding my tracks. I use encryption options where they're available. I like Apple because they do encrypt their phones pretty well, and I appreciate the stance that they took in the FBI dispute. But one of the things that I'm conscious of is that we shouldn't have to be superhuman to protect our privacy. And so when it's easy, when it doesn't take a great cost for us, then I think we should use it. But I A friend of mine, James Grimmelman, wrote a post where he said, have you heard of the Tor network, the anonymizing Tor network? Some of you may have had Professor Grimmelman here. He said, don't use Tor if you don't know how to use it, because it's really complicated. And I thought that was actually a really good piece of advice, where if you do more harm than good, or if the cost is too high, then you shouldn't be expected to use it. That's the same thing as saying you should be expected to read boilerplate terms of use, which you shouldn't, by the way. No one should ever be expected to read boilerplate terms of use, because it's the only thing we'd ever do. Like brew a big pot of coffee, you know, read your terms of use for the day, and then your day would be done. Any other questions?
That applied to, like, privacy law when they created anti-spyware law, like, a while back. It ended up making it a lot easier for people to make bots that couldn't be stopped, because I think the law was that the program itself couldn't look anywhere outside of the memory that was being used for that program. So people could screen scrape and use, like, bots off of imaging, and then the companies, this happened in online gambling and gaming, and now it's kind of spread out where the companies can't protect their own customers against botting, because if they did, they'd be breaking American anti-spyware laws. And it just kind of creates this like catch-22 where they made this old law to protect the people, but now it's actually like protecting the bad guys.
I don't know about that. And Danielle, do you know anything? But could I comment on this dynamic? Because it's something that I think is worth talking about, which is we have to be really careful when we start regulating design precisely for this reason. I'd also add that we need to be really careful in having a lot of the arguments that are coming out now is that we should have laws that engage in massive data collection limitations, right? So you shouldn't be allowed to collect certain kinds of information. That makes sense for a lot of reasons. It you know, it's got a smaller database. Something can't be hacked if it doesn't exist, right? But it also cuts against things like AI systems that need lots of data to work, right? And so particularly because now we're deploying AI systems for good data security, right? And so we have to be really slow and careful about the way in which we wade into this, because we get counterintuitive results, particularly with data security, where sometimes you need increased flexibility to protect against threats. DDoS attacks are a really good example of this too, right? Where it's like you have to have massive resources to protect against DDoS attacks. And so, anyway, that doesn't directly address your question, but I don't understand. I didn't know about the dynamic.
I guess I was wondering, like, with the law, when you create a new law to protect privacy and then it ends up, like, going in the other way in some instances, like, how can the law keep up with technology in the way that, you know, the people that are trying to make money off of botting are actually protected by the anti-spyware law?
I guess there are two answers to that. One of which is you try to create laws with enough wiggle room where you can respond. The other one is, and this is something that we're not very good at, we need to have a better discussion about what's acceptable collateral damage for certain kinds of laws, or what the trade-offs are, basically. And so what are we willing to accept, you know, basically anticipating what the fallout might be and say we can live with it as long as, you know, we can shore it up somewhere else, or talking about prioritization of, you know, we would rather have privacy, for example, than something else. But if security is paramount, then maybe that works. I mean, the tort system, for example, is one that sort of implicitly tries to balance an acknowledgement of the fact that bad things will happen, but on par, we like what we get out of it. Oh, yeah.
It turns out it's not great for creators. It's great for the middleman, right? Like I'm channeling towards after all. This is where I go off book. I don't know much about intellectual property. But, right, the idea that we sort of bake technologies into laws, that it can have an effect that we just didn't anticipate, and it can be contrary to the very reason why we have laws like DMCA.
Absolutely.
So
Is it the DMCA that you're thinking of and the anti-circumvention provisions?
No, I'm not sure. There's a specific law against spyware that prevents you from having a program look at what's going on your someone's computer, obviously, if they've downloaded it, outside of the virtual memory that that program is using. So it can look at what's happening within its own program, but it can't look outside in the rest of your computer, which is very logical that they would do that.
Right.
But if you run a bot that collects images ahead of time and then knows what the program's going to run, you can bot the program without hooking in, and these people that are doing it are protected by American anti-spyware laws, because if they made it so, and they're capable of it, so their program could look at what else is running on your computer and see that you're running a bot, they could get rid of those users, ban them, take legal action, but they aren't allowed to do that, so these botters are just immune.
And that might be an interpretation of the law that I wrote about, where you say that criminalize the manufacturer of spyware tools that are primarily designed to be secretive, and that might be an interpretation of that.
And not only that, but it's also worth sort of reading in importance for the DMCA, if it may be a corollary, where it prohibits people from sort of hacking into to protect it pieces of software, but what that does is it actually made security research very difficult, because there are lots of things that are protected, and in order to spot vulnerabilities, you have to sort of peek in, and the anti-circumvention laws prohibit that. But in that instance, I'm arguing for a good faith security research exception, and there are lots of people that are arguing for that. Yeah. All right. Thank you very much. I really appreciate it. This is a really great talk. I really enjoyed it.